My name is Kenneth Oy, and I'm a professor in political science and the Institute for Data Systems and Society, and very happy to invite you to this evening's Starr Forum. The Starr Forum tonight is on the topic of internet privacy, but we want to be working through potential challenges from governments, firms, and hackers. To set this up just a bit, an announcement first, and then back to the subject. The Starr Forum is sort of the leading series of the Center for International Studies at MIT, and this event is actually jointly sponsored by the Center and by the Internet Policy Research Initiative, which is a CSAIL activity that Danny Weitzner has created. Now, back to tonight, and there is a relationship between civil liberties and civil rights issues and our subject this evening. What we're going to be doing, in fact, before this event began, a gentleman walked up to me and said, "Privacy on the internet, you mean there is any left?" And what we're hoping to do tonight is to work through a series of issues or potential problems. We're certainly going to be talking about potential threats raised by governments, our own and others, where arguments on national security, on the one hand, often lead to varieties and forms of surveillance, but on the other hand, those very activities can pose a challenge to civil liberties. We're going to move from that topic to general protections for privacy rights on the internet. And the panel that we have to do this is one that can address the topic from a variety of perspectives. Do not assume that the positions that are advanced will necessarily associate or be correlated with people's past experience. But we're going to start with Joel Brenner. Now, Joel was actually the director of counterintelligence for the United States, and he served in two positions within the National Security Agency, as senior counsel and as the inspector general. And I mention that because Joel brings to the table extensive practical experience with security issues and potential uses of information for national security ends. But even though I've been pushing him to offer the hardest of hardline positions to set up the rest of the panel, I think he's going to try to throw us a curveball and come up with topics and positions that are far more complex. And Joel will be our lead-off speaker. Each will be speaking for between 10 and 15 minutes. Okay, Deb Hurley will be our second speaker, and Deb ran the OECD's activities on privacy in the internet, on internet policy, for a number of years out of Paris, and is currently at Harvard and Brown and in Sydney, Australia. Again, I was trying to set up stereotypical positions, but people kind of refuse to cooperate and keep coming up with more complicated points of view. I was expecting, and we'll see, robust defense of civil liberties and privacy from Deb. Now, Danny. Okay, Danny is the most problematic of characters. Okay, he sits in CSAIL right now running this Internet Policy Research Initiative. And Danny served in the White House working on these issues at the right hand of President Obama. And what he's done is try to straddle two worlds, by working on policy out of the White House on the one hand, then coming to MIT and initiating a research and policy program to be tackling and addressing potential sources of uncertainty that bear on the formulation of good policy in these very difficult areas. So I'm hoping that our speakers will revert to form and do nothing but come up with caricatures of their positions, which then makes my life as the moderator and knitter together of the event very easy. But I suspect they'll be more complicated than that. So what we're going to do is we're going to go Joel to Deb to Danny. Then I'll be a provocateur asking questions that will try to force them into corners that they'll probably resist. And I want to warn you, all three are lawyers, so they're very good at escaping. And then we'll turn to questions and answers. And Michelle and I will both be holding the microphones and during the Q&A, Oprah style. So with that, Joel, are you ready to roll?
Thanks, Ken.
Okay.
Everybody hear me okay back there? I think so. This is a vast topic, and there are many ways into it. I'm going to address it first by making a a couple of observations about the U.S. domestic scene and what I think is going on. And then I'm going to open the aperture first with an observation and a prediction about the kind of regulation and the kind of surveillance that is going to be increasingly appropriate in the future. Secondly, I'm going to make a prediction about the future of cyber mayhem and an observation about how that fits into concepts of ordered liberty. And finally, I'm going to make an observation and a prediction about the strategic direction of international affairs in this area. First, a couple of observations about what's going on in this country. Currently, in my view, the biggest threat to Americans' liberty does not come from the federal government, which is heavily regulated and effectively regulated. Not perfectly, but effectively. It comes from unregulated state and local surveillance measures, particularly the ability to conduct systematic and indiscriminate communication surveillance over wide metropolitan areas without any warrant. This is not the case in every jurisdiction, but it's the case in many jurisdictions. Right now, what I learned to call at NSA a man-in-the-middle attack, which was an ability to intercept communications and either send them where you didn't want them to go or to send them on after examining them, was a phrase nobody heard outside the intelligence business. The ability to do so is now in the hands of a couple of students who want to pool their resources and spend a few thousand dollars on this kind of equipment. You may know it as Stingray technology. That's one version of it. Patterns of movement, the ability to monitor patterns of movement of entire populations or people in the population, combined with facial recognition technology, is an enormous threat to personal liberty. And it is fundamentally beyond the public's view, notwithstanding the attempts of certain civil liberties organizations. And it is mostly unregulated, and it's very dangerous, in my opinion. Secondly, at the federal level, the single biggest governmental obstacle to enhanced privacy, and I stress governmental, since the biggest obstacles to enhanced privacy are our own behavior, the biggest governmental obstacle is the so-called third-party doctrine, by which in the United States, for some decades now, one waives all privacy interest in information given to a third party. Now, that doctrine has been under attack for some time, justifiably so, but there are reasons for optimism on this in this case. All nine justices of the Supreme Court have expressed uncomfortableness with this doctrine and its interplay with the expectation of privacy rule. And the Second Circuit, which is the Federal Appeals Court in New York, did not apply it this summer in the Stored Communication Act case involving Microsoft and Ireland, if any of you follow that. This doctrine is not going to be abandoned wholesale because it leads to predictable results. It's easy to apply. But I think the court is going to begin moving off this doctrine, and I not at all with one stroke. Now, you may well ask, would a court under Trump do that? And the answer is nobody knows, because nobody knows what sorts of persons would be appointed to the court. But I think that doctrine is probably moving in the right direction. But it is a bad doctrine. It is in need of reform. And I think the current justices all understand that. Now, let me pass on to an observation and a strategic prediction about the kind of regulation and the kind of surveillance that I think we're going to see more of in the future, and a regulatory issue. We've entered an era when the terms on which the government may search lawfully gathered information are becoming as important as the terms on which the government may lawfully collect that information. Some of you who follow the issue, the FISA 702 issue, that's one example of a much bigger issue. The government's access to vast quantities of information about U.S. persons has grown dramatically and continues to do that. The agencies hold massive databases of information about us. They also have access to readily available commercial databases through a few keystrokes or through the purchase of data from proprietary databases in the marketplace. Most of this data ocean is held by private companies whose ability to gather it and skill in chopping it up and analyzing it exceed the government's. The vast expansion of the private data market means, in my view, that the government itself will gather relatively less data and purchase relatively more of it in open markets. Historically, our laws and regulations have controlled who can collect intelligence, whose communications can be collected, how they may be collected, and what may be collected. Always an emphasis on collection. Once information about U.S. persons has been lawfully collected, we also regulate how it's disseminated and to whom, but we have not regulated the conditions or frequency under which the collecting agency may access or analyze it. Why? For perfectly good reasons. It hasn't seemed necessary to protect our liberties to do that. I think we're going to see some changes in that area. In the future, we're likely to be at least as concerned with the state's ability to access information already collected or available in the marketplace as we have been with the conditions under which the state may collect it using its own resources. I can't say for sure that's going to happen, but I think this is a fundamental issue going forward. And it is being exacerbated or brought to the fore, if you will, because the task of intelligence has changed significantly in the last 20 years. In the Cold War, the problem wasn't to understand who the enemy was. We knew that. The issue was how to get their communications, not who to collect. Now the issue isn't how to read the collect those communications, but whose communications do we want to collect? That is the hard part. That is why big data metadata analysis has become the not the only, but a major focus of the intelligence communities, and why it will continue to be, not because the intelligence communities are eager to do that, because that is the challenge that they now face. Let me move on to a different subject. That's the future of cyber mayhem and what it means for our liberty. Last Friday, the recently retired director of cybersecurity for AT&T wrote an open letter to President-elect Trump in which he said, I quote, "I believe that recent advances in offensive capability make it inevitable that significant large-scale cyber attacks will be launched against our critical infrastructure during your time in office. These attacks will shift from the theft of intellectual property to destructive attacks aimed at disrupting our ability to live as free American citizens. I do not know of a single cybersecurity expert in our country, and Ed Amoroso knows them all, who would disagree with this view." Mr. Amoroso is correct. And critical infrastructure, and I'm talking about electricity, finance to some degree, transportation, oil and gas, communications, and what have you, are fundamentally largely unprepared for this. Now, I remind you that there is no liberty without order. We can sometimes doubt that or forget it only because we've been able to take order for granted for a very long time in this country. But a successful attack on the electricity grid or a couple of major banks being taken down would really change that, could bring this country to a halt, and would have repercussions on civil liberties that would be appalling. Whether this country can pull itself together before that happens remains to be seen. But my point to you is, if you care about civil liberties, you must care about the security of the country. Finally, the international scene. We read a great deal about squabbles between the United States and the EU, something that Deborah has a lot of experience with. These are difficult, they're annoying for both sides. They will be worked out because the consequences of not doing so are too great for both sides. What is happening beyond the public's attention in this country are things like model legislation coming out of the International Telecommunications Union, which is a branch of the agency of the UN, on model legislation for cybercrime, which is fundamentally an attack on humane, relatively free international order, being led by Russia and China, in an attempt to make state control of communications and expression the international norm. We are now living in an era in which the institutions, international institutions, we have taken for granted, and our ability to lead those institutions is very much in doubt. We are also seeing data localization laws, even in democracies. So I have a prediction. If you haven't figured it out already, we don't live in a borderless, denationalized, ideal world, and the fissures are getting larger, not smaller. We're going to see more assertion of sovereign power over communications, much of it in a highly illiberal fashion. The forms and extent are unclear, but it's, I believe, going to be worse before it gets better. The world is sorting itself out into a new order, and the ability of the United States to lead that reshaping, let alone to reshape the entire world in its image, which has been the foolhardy and disastrous project of the last 25 years, is very much in doubt. Thank you.
You can either go to the podium or sit if you wish.
I think I am mic'd. Am I set? Okay. I guess I'll stay here. Good evening. Ken, thank you very much for inviting me. I'm here to talk about the subjects that Ken identified. Almost 500 years ago in 1517, so nearly 500 years ago, Martin Luther nailed the 35 Theses to the door of the church. And so he was at that point speaking truth to power. The sale of indulgences bothered him. He felt that it was, you know, something really incorrect and really going to the heart of the church. So it really doesn't matter what you think of Catholicism, Protestantism, the Reformation, or any of that. The notion was someone who looked at the existing power structure and wanted to comment on that and wanted to intercede on that and use his ability to say what he thought was right. Now, I'm not here to talk to you tonight about a German theologian from the Middle Ages, but I will mention a few Americans as we talk about this tonight. So Ken's given us about 10 minutes, so I'm going to make approximately 10 points. That's really pushing it in 10 minutes. But let me start with, why is this important? So again, talking to a group at MIT, you guys are extremely technically sophisticated, unlike everybody else out on the sidewalk, you know, most of the people on the planet who don't understand what's happening. I don't like to talk about the internet. I think it's too narrow. I don't like to talk about the World Wide Web. I think it's too narrow. I like to talk about the ubiquitous information environment. So this is very familiar to most of you here, where computing is not only happening in solids, it's happening in liquids, it's happening in the air we breathe. And so we really have a pervasive environment where computing activity is happening all around you, in you, you're inhaling it, some of it rides out on the exhale, some of it stays in your body and calls home or calls the doctor or tells you something or whatever. But this idea of computing activity happening everywhere and all around you, and some of it, just as your breathing is not really consciously monitored by you, you know, things are being measured or information is being gathered about you that's really beyond your awareness or your conscious awareness to know about. So again, DNA is just a data tape, and there are many, many examples, and for lack of time, I won't give you, I'll just give you one. I just read the other day about 3D printed epilepsy medication. So the idea of that is it's printed so it can be designed for that individual. The dosage can be designed, the shape of the pill can be designed to be taken more easily by children or elders or whatever it is, or for release of the medication over time, this will all be designed to the individual, or even the prescription can be sent to the home and downloaded and printed in your own 3D printer, again, organic printing and so forth. So the idea of this really ubiquitous information environment. So we talk about privacy and security, we need to consider it in that context. So I'm preaching to the choir here, you don't think it's science fiction. So now when we turn to privacy, privacy, first of all, is a human right. There's no question about that. It is a human right. By the way, December 10th is International Human Rights Day. It's a Saturday. You can sleep late and still do something for human rights on December 10th. The Universal Declaration of Human Rights is what establishes clearly privacy as a human right. So Eleanor Roosevelt, that's one of the Americans I wanted to mention to you, she chaired the committee that created the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. It was done from the ashes of World War II, so people who'd known the horror of that and the destruction and wanted to put a stake in the ground on the other side. So an international committee was created, and in less than 2 years, which I will tell you, in international time is the speed of light, they created this Universal Declaration of Human Rights, which was then unanimously adopted, establishing privacy as a human right. This is not in dispute. In the United States, people don't realize this. The U.S. is a signatory to conventions that say this. I like to ask the U.S. government from time to time, are you in violation of your international treaty obligations in not providing sufficient privacy protection for Americans? So we have, by 1976, that was 1948, there were two additional conventions adopted. Those three together are called the International Bill of Human Rights, and those have been in place for a number of years. I also want to mention to another American, who is Louis Brandeis, who locally here in the Cambridge area wrote the seminal article, The Right to Privacy, which kind of was the firing gun for the modern era of privacy protection. It actually began in the United States in the 1880s or so, but that article in the early 1900s by Brandeis was really a start to think about it, and was developed in response to the challenge of new technologies at that time, the photographs, photography. So privacy is a human right, but then also personal data has economic value. And usually we crash on the rocks of that and people aren't able to move forward with these two concepts. But I believe in Piaget's ideas that we can have a concept, we can have another concept, we can think about how they oppose each other, and eventually we can reconcile these concepts and have them think of a way to have them live together. So certainly personal data has economic value. What we see today is you're just giving it all away. Facebook takes all the value from you. But we can certainly reconcile these two ideas of privacy being a human right and privacy having and personal data having economic value. And I'll just give you two brief examples. Where we have something that has both the aspects of a human right or a very personal right and an economic right. One of them is within copyright law, not in the American system, but in many systems around the world. There's something called moral rights in copyright in the works you create. So you have the economic right and you also have a moral right. So if I paint a painting and you buy it, you own it, you can sell it, you can display it and so forth, and you can do all the things you think you might be able to do with it. But what you cannot do is you cannot destroy it, because that would violate my moral right. So again, there's this coexistence, and these laws have existed for over 100 years now in many countries around the world. Even within privacy itself, there's something called the right of publicity, which incorporates both a privacy right and an economic right there. So the central question to me then becomes, where is the locus of ownership and control? And in my view, the individual must own and control their personal information. So in many places around the world, this is settled. In the United States, this is not settled. And part of the reason for that, a big part of the reason, is the third party doctrine that Joel just mentioned. There's also this issue of proportionality. So you want to make sure that the solution, whatever it is, whether it's legislation, a technical measure, whatever, is proportional to the problem you're trying to fix. So don't use a hammer to kill a fly. So we have many examples that we could give of disproportionate privacy solutions or security solutions. But one of the examples might be the sort of biometric ID. So it's sold to people unwittingly. They don't understand what they're doing. They agree to a biometric being taken. It's sold on the basis of convenience or ease. You don't have to remember a password. But they're giving over then And in U.S. law, then it can be disseminated, matched with their insurance record, employment record, school record, every other record, and sold over and over again. They're giving a unique, although, again, you here will know the dirty secret, it's not quite unique, but a unique, durable identifier of themselves and others who are genetically related to them. I want to comment a bit on this European view of privacy, because the implication there when it's said is that it's foreign. You know, it's foreign. Somehow it's foreign. It's European to care about privacy. There are others over there, and they're Europeans who care about privacy. But I want to remind you that the genesis of the modern, I mentioned Louis Brandeis already, but in the mid-70s, again, in the face of computerization, there was a growth of recognition that we could have this massive collection of personal records, and we needed to safeguard against that. And the engine of that was the United States government. And the U.S. government in 1974 adopted the U.S. Privacy Act, which covered the federal, which still covers the federal public sector. And the reason it only covers the federal public sector was because at the time, the view was that there was going to be one big mainframe, right? Not many little brothers. And who, if there was one big mainframe, who would own it? The government. So, and then eventually, you know, it was realized, obviously, that there would be computers everywhere, including in the private sector, and so many countries then either adopted laws that covered both the public and private sector or amended their law, if it had been adopted earlier, to include the private sector. The U.S. did not, for a series of reasons. So the U.S. has become, even though the U.S. started this very strong trend, went diplomatically around the world, urging other countries to adopt data protection laws through the 70s, 80s, and 90s, participated in an early international agreement about privacy and data protection, the U.S. gradually became the outlier of this incredibly strong trend that it created over 30 years, so that now we have a situation where Americans have much less privacy protection than people in over 100 countries around the world that have data protection laws. And most of those 100 countries are not in Europe. They're all over the place. I'm going to mention something a little bit in a minute under the heading of, are you kidding me? I'm going to get to that in a minute. But what we see now in the United States is the U.S. is rediscovering privacy. And you see this trendlet starting again. And it's not really a matter of me wearing rosy-colored glasses. It's actually surprised me. But I see it happening, and it's been going on now for several years. First of all, you see U.S. companies getting religion on privacy. Did they do that through altruism? No. They did it because after Edward Snowden, they started losing market share around the world, and they had to respond to that. So you see U.S. companies starting to care more about privacy and including that more in their public policy making, including it in their products, including it in the way that they would talk to their customers. So we have U.S. companies getting religion on privacy. In addition, the primary voice on privacy in the United States over the last 20 years or so has been the FTC, the Federal Trade Commission, which I call necessary but not sufficient. Their mandate doesn't actually give them the range of powers that they would need to actually comprehensively protect personal data and privacy, but they hold their corner. And so the FTC has been our acting for us in the privacy domain, although not comprehensively. I will mention, though, actually, that the U.S. did have a privacy commissioner, similar to other countries, back under President George Herbert Walker Bush, in the White House, assigned to think about privacy and to represent the U.S. internationally. But recently, in addition to the FTC, the FCC, the Federal Communications Commission, has started to weigh in very heavily about privacy. And they come out recently with several rulings and decisions which actually echo very strongly the provisions of these international agreements and legislation around the world that the U.S. started. I want to turn briefly to privacy, and I'm going to hinge here, and it's not a matter of balancing, because I hate that word, balancing privacy and security. When someone starts talking about that, just shut the door and leave and go have ice cream or something, because it's really a useless kind of conversation. Really, privacy and security are mutually reinforcing each other. You can, if you protect personal data better, you've improved the security of the system overall. By providing more security in the system, you'll protect the personal data in it. And actually, as an example, almost every privacy statute, it's way down in Article 21 or Article 17, pretty far down, but there's a very explicit requirement that sufficient security measures be put in place to protect the personal data in that system. So let me just mention with regard to security. We've had the party, and now we have the hangover, right? So 25 years ago, we knew what needed to be done to protect systems and to deal with security of information systems, but we didn't do it. And there were several very obvious reasons why we didn't do that, and perhaps we can get into that in the discussion. But now, so we've allowed these systems to burgeon, increasingly insecure, and so now we're suffering the hangover of it. And under the heading of, are you kidding me, let me just give you one example. Many of you will be familiar with the smart plugs now, and actually they're being marketed heavily as the dad's Christmas gift this year, right? Don't want to get him another tie. What do you get dads? We don't know. Get him a smart plug, and we'll give you 40% off for it. But the smart plugs, many of them have wired or have included in them, built into the hardware, the default user ID and password. It's built right in there. So you bring right in that note of vulnerability. Of course, many of you will be familiar with the recent DDoS attack. So we have something in the United States called the Underwriters Laboratory. You cannot plug a lamp into a wall unless it meets the Underwriter Laboratory requirements. But you can plug that smart plug in. And by plugging in that smart plug, it's as if you're inviting someone into your home, a stranger, letting them sit down, letting them look around, letting them look through your doors, look through your fridge, walk all around, invite other people in, make calls when you're not home, and so forth. How many people would do that if they knew about it? And that's why I say, are you kidding me? Because Americans who don't know this, you know this, I know this, most people don't know this, are gleefully going out and paying the money to buy it and having it gift wrapped and putting it under the tree. So this is not a trick question, but is this the kind of thing we want to be doing? I just want to mention, because Jill mentioned it, and maybe we can talk about it during the discussion, is averting cyber war, I call it. And I've been running a project for the last 2 years on averting cyber war. And there are a number of steps that are being taken internationally to move us back from that 5 minutes to midnight situation that we're finding ourselves in. Thank you.
So, 10 minutes, three topics, and I'm going to have to resist responding to all the extraordinary things that both Deborah and Joel have said. I'll try to restrain myself until we get to questions. I want to talk about why we care about privacy. I want to talk about what our challenges are going forward. And I do want to talk a little bit about what privacy might look like under President Trump. Why do we care about privacy? It's really interesting. We've had this very distinguished, learned, expert panel talking about privacy for 40 minutes, and no one said what privacy is. There's lots of examples of individual instances of privacy, but we don't, I would suggest, really have a common view. It's fine to say that we have an international treaty that says privacy is a fundamental human right. But if you look carefully at that, the definition of there is awfully thin, and the countries that have been allowed to say that they have privacy rights include countries like Russia. So I'm not sure we really have a global view, with or without the U.S., of what privacy really is in international law yet. But I think that we have confusion about what privacy is for a more fundamental reason. I want to suggest to you, following a colleague of mine at the iSchool at Berkeley, Deirdre Mulligan. Deirdre talks about privacy as what a kind of a hoary old Cambridge political theorist, W.B. Golley, called an essentially contested concept. So privacy is an essentially contested concept, I would suggest. What is an essentially contested concept? It's something that we really care about as a culture, as a society, that we all agree is important but have a hard time understanding and defining, but we still care about it. So religion is an essentially contested concept. Art is an essentially contested concept. Democracy is an essentially contested concept. We would say those things are all wonderful and important, but we basically argue about them in perpetuity as part of their existence in our cultures. Privacy, I want to suggest, may be in that category. Because when we talk about privacy, we mean so many different things. Deborah went back to, 1517, 1517. We could go back to about the 7th century before the Common Era and find examples in ancient Jewish law about what privacy was. You can find it in religious and legal traditions all over the place. But let me say a little bit about what we mean by privacy in the U.S. context, and just to give you an idea of how different even the concepts of privacy are within one legal system. There is no mention of privacy in the U.S. Constitution, as many of you know. However, in the First Amendment, which guarantees freedom of religion and freedom of expression and freedom of the press, as we know, the First Amendment also guarantees freedom of association. That is a core privacy concept. When the Supreme Court over time has looked at what does privacy mean, one of the key principles the Supreme Court has defended is to protect people against infringements on our right to freedom of association, to protect people against intrusion from government that might chill our freedom of association. So freedom of association is privacy. We care about privacy a lot because it's a tool, it's a legal tool and a concept we use to limit the power of big institutions. Whether it's to limit the power of governments, the Fourth Amendment to the U.S. Constitution was about, really originated in many ways before the United States even existed. It was about keeping the king out of your house. It was about keeping those soldiers who were oppressing us in the United States out of our houses. So we depend on privacy in the same way to try to place some limits about how much companies that have large amounts of information about us and large analytic power to protect us from those institutions. So privacy is about limiting power. Privacy is also very much about fairness. Some of our best privacy laws, I don't want you to get too alarmed by Deborah's characterization. We actually have a lot of privacy laws in the United States. We have 16 major federal privacy laws. We have a bunch of federal agencies that enforce privacy very aggressively all over the place. What we don't have, which is what Europe has, is one single privacy law. I actually like having a lot of little privacy laws rather than one big one, because I think we do a better job of enforcing them, but we can debate that. But under the scope of all those different privacy laws, in many cases, what you see is the federal government trying to protect citizens against unfair collection or use of their personal information, whether it's in the context of health or financial services. The Obama administration launched the new Consumer Financial Protection Bureau, which has enormous power and has used it to protect people against the misuse of personal information in the context of financial services. So under this rubric of privacy, we mean so many different things. I will just point a little bit to what Trump might mean about privacy. We don't really know yet. Trump, ironically, I think, may harken back, unfortunately, to the kind of elitist side of Justice Louis Brandeis. Justice Brandeis was a very important thinker in the development of U.S. privacy law, but I would suggest he was an elitist and a paternalistic person in many ways. He deployed privacy in many ways as a way to limit transparency. The article that he wrote that kind of launched the idea of the right to privacy was about protecting the daughter of the innocent daughter of a friend of his right here in the Boston area from prying photographers. So there's and when you hear President-elect Trump talk about privacy, sometimes what you hear him talk about is the intrusion of the press on people's private lives, including public officials like himself. So I think we're going to have a whole discussion about that notion of privacy as well. Here's one thing that I think privacy really isn't, and one way that I think we've really taken a wrong turn in many ways right here at MIT. Sometimes people mistakenly conflate privacy with security. Sometimes we think that if we could only keep our data secure and secret, that we would have perfect privacy protection. Now, in a very simplistic way, that's of course true. If you could take all your personal information and wrap it up in a wonderful cryptographic bundle and carry it around with you wherever you wanted to have it, of course you would, in some sense, have a kind of a perfect privacy environment. But what you'd also have is no ability to interact with the rest of the world. You'd have no ability to speak to people. You'd no ability to engage in commercial interactions. If you kept all your data secret, you'd be a hermit. And One of the things that I think we got a little confused about in the computer science community is conflating the fact that we have extraordinary abilities to deploy cryptographic technology to keep data secret, that we've conflated that with privacy, that we think if we only could have that kind of cryptographic protection, we would have perfect privacy. And I would suggest, as Deborah and Joel have pointed out, that privacy is a much more complex kind of quantity, and we're not going to get it with just the simple application of cryptography. Cryptography is enormously important for computer security and in some cases for privacy. But if we depend on technical mechanisms alone to protect our privacy, we're adopting, I think, a very impoverished notion of what privacy is. What are some of the challenges that we face? Well, the challenges have been alluded to, and I think that the two really significant challenges that I keep coming back to are, number one, that it is very hard to depend on what people in the privacy business call collection limitation. It used to be, to a certain extent, that computer systems were small scale enough, were kind of off to the side of our lives enough, that we could just hope to have less personal information collected about us as a way to protect privacy. I think that what we all know now is that there's constantly information being collected about us for good and for bad reasons, and that we have to think much beyond just limiting who has what access to data if we really want to think about privacy. I think a related challenge we have is that it used to be possible to think much more, with much more confidence, that we could study trends in data and still keep the identity of individuals represented in those data sets anonymous. I think what we're learning is that it is very, very easy, because of the analytic capabilities that we have, to re-identify people in very complex data sets. So the ability to hide in the middle of data sets is something that we're really losing. I think the second challenge we have, and Joel alluded to this, is that the lines between the government and the private sector are really blurring. The commercial services that we use are stand-ins in many ways, or end up as agents of government surveillance after the fact. It's not because they intend to function that way, most of them, but because of the fact that the government has the ability, government all around the world has the ability to legally compel private companies to turn over personal data about us with the appropriate legal process, as we build this extraordinarily powerful and innovative and creative information environment, we are at the same time building an extraordinarily powerful surveillance environment. I don't think it's all that likely that we'll stop doing that anytime soon, but we have a real challenge in making sure that we have the right kinds of limitations on the power that government has to get information from those private sources. I think another challenge that I'm increasingly aware of is that there are really times when privacy rules impede important research. If you talk with people in the life sciences communities, and some of you may be doing this research, you will find people in the healthcare environment who really ask many fewer questions than they would like of the data that's out there about individuals. We have a growing amount of health information in digital form, and I think that in general, you find people in life sciences research are extremely cautious about just what they can do with that data, and hold back because A, they don't want to do anything that they think would be morally wrong, and B, they don't want to get into trouble with whoever they're legally responsible to. And I think we are probably losing a huge amount of valuable scientific insight that could help with medical problems that we face, that could help with public infrastructure problems that we face, like how to make our transportation systems more efficient, because we don't really know how to navigate through the very complex privacy questions. I respect the fact that researchers are cautious, but I think we may not be providing researchers adequate guidance on how to do aggressive research and innovative research that still respects privacy but produces important public value. So just to wrap up, what might privacy look like under President-elect Trump? I think that there's going to be a central conundrum that the president-elect faces in trying to figure out, is he a populist or an elitist when it comes to privacy? You've seen both impulses. He may say, this whole information environment is rigged, and we need to protect people from it in the same way we need to protect people from big banks or from bad trade deals. By some strange set of circumstances, maybe the Federal Trade Commission will get a really strong new chair to enforce privacy rules. I don't know how likely I think that is, but I do think there's obviously a populist strand in the president-elect's thinking and in his appeal, and how that manifests itself in privacy, I think is going to be quite interesting. He may go for just a sort of a more traditional Republican deregulatory approach to privacy. But the third possibility, which I think we understand how to deal with, the third possibility is that there certainly are a lot of indications of hostility from the president-elect about the transparency and accountability functions of the press. And very often, privacy can be used as a way to avoid accountability. Peter Thiel, who is a well-known supporter of the president-elect's, as some of you know, has gone on a big campaign against the not all that savory news-ish site Gawker, and essentially put them out of business because some time ago they outed him as being gay. He then supported a libel lawsuit brought by, what's his name, Hulk Hogan. And so there you have notions that sort of come awfully close to ideas about privacy or at least control of personal information that end up getting used in ways that I think are quite undemocratic and contrary to principles of accountability that are really important to the way our government works. I don't think that's consistent with a full understanding of privacy, but I think it's possible to wrap those kinds of restrictions on the flow of information under the guise of privacy. So we'll have an interesting ride, I have no doubt, under President-elect Trump, who we know is very, very aware of the power of digital media, is very, very aware of protecting certain aspects of at least his personality. We'll see whether that extends to protecting anyone else's personality. And we'll learn a lot more as time goes on. Thanks.
So I'm gonna actually hit these guys with a question. And then what we'll be doing is moving to the floor for your questions and your comments. Briefly put, in summary, we've actually heard discussion of points of tension across security and privacy, Deb, your comment notwithstanding, and efficiency and innovation. I mean, Danny, you were talking about how our concerns with privacy may at times limit good uses of data that could provide broader benefits. So that's kind of one set of issues that have popped up. But another big issue that was sitting here in all three of the presentations was how the line between government and the private sector has blurred. Joel was talking about how governments will gather less and purchase more. Okay, and both Danny and Deb also moved into that. Now, let me move into this just a little bit and force the issue. So we do have companies that are acquiring massive amounts of data with our nominal consent. And we acquiesce in this because it's convenient, because it makes our lives easier. Okay, the biometrics to get around having to keep track of passwords. Google Maps, but are providing our locations to make that service work better. Facebook feeds that are obviously based on a heck of a lot of information on what we've been interested in before. Insurance breaks offered by accepting little devices that snoop on us all the time. So whether it be Google, Facebook, or Flow and Progressive Insurance, there's a heck of a lot of data acquisition going on. And here's the question that I want to pose to each of you. Joel, in particular, you were saying the government can get a lot of this information from these sources of information, or it might have been Apple providing a key to a back door, or it might have been actually telecommunications companies providing metadata to your old employer. So we have a whole series of points of tension or confrontation between companies and governments, where governments are asking companies to turn stuff over, either for pay or for not. And to what extent should companies be free to refuse those offers, or those offers that cannot be refused? Each of you has spoken to this in slightly different ways, but I just want to pin you guys down a little bit on whether private actors should be free to tell the government, we don't want to provide you with the keys to the kingdom or the data, even though we are not necessarily challenging your good intentions.
I thought you were going to ask a hard question. What you're asking...
I'm counting on these guys to make it a hard question.
Look,
so Joel, you go first.
Let me rephrase the question. Does an individual citizen have the right to ignore the writ of a lawfully constituted court? This is an easy question. And the answer is no. And
unless it's unconstitutional.
I mean, the important issue is, under what circumstance can the government demand this? That is the really nub of the matter. And that is why I think we allow too much information to be gathered at government demand without warrant. And we could get specific about that, although that might get us too far into the weeds tonight. But I think if you pose the question as, under what circumstances can a company or a person ignore an issue, say, of court? This question answers itself, Ken.
Now, there's a follow-up to that. Obviously, you never ask questions to lawyers without having a follow-up ready. And the follow-up in this case is this. To what extent should companies be free to structure how they store the data and how they access the data in order to make it impossible for them to comply with said orders? Because frankly, I can think of a number of ways to make it hard to comply, and if I want to be trusted in the international environment, I may well want to set up how I do business in a way to make it impossible for me to say yes to Joel.
Can I comment on this? I mean, there are two answers to this. I'll just give right off the bat. One, Apple versus FBI. Okay, enough said. Everybody knows what the outcome was there. You know, they weren't going to do it. They went and hired an Israeli team to hack it. But the in terms of Apple's response to it, because that's where your question is, what should corporations be doing? Corporations are clearly beholden to their shareholders. That's what they have to think about, and then their customers. So in Apple versus FBI, Apple's like, we're not doing it. Here's another example. So that's a popular example everybody knows about. Another example is Microsoft has brought a lawsuit about what are called national security letters, where the government seeks information from companies about particular customers of Microsoft or Google or whomever it is. And these national security letters require the companies to never reveal that they've received the request, not reveal to the person the request was made of,
That's
and
right.
so forth. There are a number of aspects to this. So Microsoft brought suit not too long ago to say, you know, we can't exist under this regime. You know, because a lot of this was put in place after 9/11 when, you know, kind of all the silos just got knocked down and water was flooding everywhere. Everything was suddenly allowed. So now there's some pushback. And what's interesting also is the number of not only advocacy groups, but companies and many, many of the big companies that have joined and filed amicus briefs in support of Microsoft's position. And this has been going through the court system now. And so we'll see how it comes out. So, I mean, there are very clear examples, and there are other examples
as
well.
So there's two cases involving Microsoft, and I think it's worth looking at them together. The first, well, temporarily, it's the second one.
Yeah.
The more recent one that Deborah
Ireland
mentioned is actually Microsoft claiming a First Amendment right to be able to speak about their the right. surveillance requests that have come to them. It has nothing to do with whether the surveillance requests are legal or not, or whether they will comply with them. They're just saying they want to be able to, you know, disclose how much surveillance they're being asked to do on behalf of the government. That's one case, and I think there's a pretty strong argument that says that's on the right side of transparency and accountability. We don't want a surveillance system where all the surveillance that goes on is secret. That's a bad idea. But the other Microsoft case, I think, is a little more challenging. And this is a case in which Microsoft was served with an ordinary court order that said that asked for email from one of its customers in the course of a criminal investigation. This was Microsoft in the U.S., asked by the FBI, I guess, said, we want this email, and the government got a court order according to all the appropriate procedures, as often happens. And Microsoft said, sorry, we can't give you that particular set of email because it's stored in Ireland. Microsoft has a data center in Ireland. Yeah. It ends up that when you sign up for Hotmail or whichever mail, free web mail service, if you have a cell phone number that has a European country code, they store all your account data in Ireland, not in the US. And Microsoft said, sorry, we can't turn over that data because it's in Ireland. And they had a kind of a complicated set of explanations that it might violate European privacy law, that actually the US government really should go to the Irish court, not to the US court, that a US court couldn't order data from Ireland to be turned over to the US government. And I found, and interestingly, basically all the privacy advocacy organizations jumped on this case in support of Microsoft, basically because they said, oh good, this is a way to limit surveillance, right? It says this limits the surveillance power that the US government has. Here's what and I was somewhat troubled by this case, and I'm curious what Joel and Deborah think about it. I was troubled by it because it seems to stand for the proposition in a way that, as Ken suggested, a global company like Microsoft or Google or eBay or any of the other internet companies can just move data somewhere else, and then if there's a law that they may be violating that's a privacy law, some other kind of consumer protection law, that company can just say, sorry, the data that you want, that you say is harming That's right. consumers is somewhere else, so go there. So I'm sort of uneasy about that case, and I think what it even though I think Microsoft was trying to stand up for the privacy rights of its users, I think it did it in a way that said, we think we're a little bit more powerful than any national government, and I'm not sure that's a good thing.
I read the case a little differently. I thought when I first heard about that case that it involved the jurisdiction of a federal court to order an American citizen to produce information held overseas that they had control over, and it doesn't. It went off on a very technical reading of the Stored Communications Act,
yes,
involving the meaning of the word warrant as opposed to order.
Well, you're now obscuring my larger policy point with details, so
I don't know.
I don't like that.
But you know, Congress can change that. Congress can change that. And I'll tell you why I think it was surprised me, but why I think it was a good decision. Do the mirror image case. Alibaba has a big data center in New Mexico or Arizona.
Yep.
And they're doing business with American citizens. They're competing with Amazon or whatever. And the Chinese government issues an order for Alibaba to produce in Beijing information about you and me that it wants to gather. How do we feel about that?
But now, that also isn't the case.
No, that's going to be the case, Danny.
Okay.
I really believe that is going to be the case.
Yeah.
This is an international world.
Right, and what I would want to say in that case is, we will not allow data to be turned over absent the rule of law. The reason...
Whose law?
Well, this is where the U.S. and other democracies have to develop a bit of a backbone and have to say, we have certain... Just as is done in... You know, there are plenty of countries that argue that the U.S. has inadequate privacy protections. We, the U.S., I would submit, have better protections against surveillance for our citizens than any other country in the world. Yeah. Any other large country in the world.
I think that's right.
Should be standing up for that.
All right, but I think that it would be very difficult if the Microsoft case came out differently for us to object to what I'm posing as the mirror image case. And we would not have wanted that. I think it would have been a big outcry in the United States, which is why having that case go off on technical and not jurisdictional grounds was a good thing. And the Congress can change it by changing one word in that statute they want to.
I want to make a meta. I'm not going to talk about Ireland, Microsoft versus Ireland anymore, although it is interesting. But I want to make a meta point here, which I ran out of time to do before, which is whose rules apply. So this is another one of these points that I wanted to make, because if you think about the cloud, you think about how data is organized now, it's sliced and diced, it's moving dynamically, there are pieces of the datum that are in various places, we're not quite sure where it was 5 minutes ago, or it would be huge to track it, and so forth. So when you think about operating in the world, and not only legally, but it interests companies, governments, individuals, what you want is certainty, predictability, and uniformity. Certainty, what are the rules? Predictability, that the rules aren't going to change in 5 minutes. And uniformity, as I move through whatever space I'm in, whether data traveling globally or me in Massachusetts or whatever, I want to have uniformity of the rule. I don't have to constantly be changing. So there are four buckets by which we make rules in the world, right? Law, standards, technology, or you can instantiate it in some way, and norms, social norms or economic norms. Those are the four ways we make rules. So one of the things that's happening now is that in terms of laws, which has been one of our big rule sticks and one of the big four buckets, they're jurisdictionally based, which means they're geographically based. Meanwhile, we have this data flowing all over the place and we don't even know where it is. So the question is, whose rules apply? So how do we begin to grapple with that issue? And I'll just mention two things briefly. One is there's a new standard, international standard, ISO 27018, which is the first privacy and personal data standard that exists. It actually, Danny, mirrors a lot of those 100-plus laws in terms of the kind of provisions it has in it. But it's something that a company or anyone can go and say, I'm following ISO 27018, so what I'm doing then is acceptable, and it's close enough to almost every law of various countries that it would map onto it. So that's one way to do. How do you deal with this fact that the data is everywhere? So this international standard. Another way, and I'm involved in a few projects, and I'm really interested to hear what you guys might think about this, is how do we instantiate in the code these kind of rule systems so they travel with the data or the pieces of the data?
And on that note, we are going to open to the floor. Why don't you, Michelle, there's a question way in the back. Now, I'm asking that these be questions and not long speeches.
Or short speeches.
And I'm asking our panelists to cooperate on that point as well. Okay.
Okay, if you don't like the way that the Chinese government may get information from private companies, how do you like, as Edward Snowden revealed, that the NSA turns over unredacted raw metadata to the State of Israel, to the IDF infamous unit 8200, which contains information not only about political activists and Palestinian Americans' communications back and forth between the region, which can easily be identified through that. And not long ago, over 40 of the veterans of the Unit 8200 actually revealed and stated that much of that information is used not to prevent terrorism, but for political persecution of Palestinians within the occupied lands and also within Israel. So we're already doing that.
Okay, so who'd like to take a question again on...
And I'll answer that.
Yeah, go ahead.
I don't like it too much. I don't agree with a great deal of what you said, but I don't like it too much. But it's a different question. And if you want to change the subject, we could change the subject. But the issue here was quite different. And the fact that you could point to something in the past about how one of our agencies behaved really doesn't change the question about what's, as Deborah said, what sort of uniform rules we want to apply to commercial information.
Okay. Questions? Yeah.
So I have a question, somewhat at a smaller level. You know, every time that we access websites, we are agreeing to privacy terms and conditions very quickly. And I doubt that many read it. I don't. Is there a requirement of what data they can collect? Or, you know, it should be, from our standpoint, something quite simple, like you're used to reading the nutrition label on food, that, you know, we're selling your data, or, you know, whatever we're collecting. Are there any such requirements? Because as a consumer, we don't have a choice. Right. If you don't accept, you're left out.
Right. So in U.S. law, there's a kind of a bifurcation. If the website you're talking about, for example, is your bank's website or it's your hospital's website, if it has medical information on it, then there are a lot of prescriptive rules about exactly what can be collected, who can do what with it, all that. If it's a kind of a in the general category of a commercial interaction that you have with a Facebook or a Google or a Twitter or eBay or whoever it might be, then, as Deborah said, that falls under the jurisdiction of the Federal Trade Commission, which has kind of an interesting combination of very broad but not very specific authority to do two things: to protect consumers against practices that are either unfair or deceptive. Now, a deceptive practice is one where the company says something in its terms of service which you either read or you didn't, and then they do something else. So the FTC has gone after hundreds and hundreds of companies for promising one thing and doing something else. And it is clear on the one hand that users don't read these policies, and I don't think anyone believes that there's a what you would call in law a bargain for exchange, that there's a real negotiation that goes on. But what you've had over a period of time is a set of standards that the FTC expects about what should be in those policies. If, for example, there's data collected and you have no way to opt out of it, the FTC will consider that unfair and will go after that website. And again, if the company promises one thing and then does something else, for example, Google, when it tried to put together Google Plus, their effort at a social network service, basically took all the data they had about all of us who use any of Google services and started to do a whole bunch of different things with it that were never described in Google's policy. And so they were fined, it was about $10 million, I think, by the Federal Trade Commission. And they're actually now under a 20-year kind of audit requirement by the FTC. So every year, the FTC goes to Google and checks to make sure they're still following these rules. Clearly, I think that those rules are not sufficient. When I was in the government, we introduced what we called the Consumer Privacy Bill of Rights that would have had much more prescriptive rules. The U.S. Congress, unfortunately, never passed it. I think that what you have in absence of prescriptive rules is you have the Federal Trade Commission gradually, on a kind of a case-by-case basis, upping the ante on what these requirements are.
Can I just comment briefly on this? I mean, first of all, I call privacy policies a Band-Aid over an unwashed wound. In other words, if you have a cut and it's got dirt in it and so forth, it's better to leave it open, you know, so that air and sunlight can get at it. Instead, these things are not enforceable, they're purposely obfuscatory, et cetera. So that's a problem, right? There are privacy policies and there are websites you can find them, and there are actually quite a number of them now that just say, we do not collect your personal information, period. That's their privacy policy. So you can have a one-line policy. Or I've seen some companies that need something a little more complex, but they are trying to communicate more clearly with their audience, where they'll have even a simple thing where, you know, there's like, say, for children, there are certain rules related to children. Well, it could be something that'll say, here's our rule on children. You can click on it if it applies to you or your family, but otherwise it's not making the thing 50 pages long. I will mention, too, there's a phenomenon in Norway called slow TV. Some of you may be devotees of this. So they have slow TV, and the winter's long there, it's dark, and this is quite a phenomenon and a trend, and there are all kinds of examples of slow TV concerts that go on for a day and so forth. So anyway, what they did, and you can look this up on the web, is they did a 32-hour program of people reading privacy policy terms and conditions as one of their
It is a true fact that if you add up all the Apple privacy policies, it's longer than Hamlet. This is true.
So it was a 32-hour Norwegian TV program.
Well, okay, Joel, do you want to get in on this, or if not?
It's not written in iambic either, I'll tell you. No. I'm glad we're back to the privacy. I just want to make an observation. I don't want to derail this conversation. The subject's terribly important. But we're not really, I like your concept of privacy as a contested concept. But we're really not talking about privacy at large. We are talking about an important but narrow piece of it. Nothing more than data regulation. Data regulation is really important, which is why we're here talking about it. But I would assert that privacy is fundamentally a disposition. It is a cultural disposition, which we are not going to touch tonight. And it's a terribly important aspect of the subject. I've written it at length on it.
How many people feel you have some amount of privacy in your online interactions? Some.
Some. Not much.
Okay, some.
Now,
how many feel you have none?
Potentially. Yeah, most, not much.
All right. Okay.
Yeah.
Now, a question to the three of you
on
this point.
Before you go there, Ken, on this privacy thing. It is a philosophical construct. It can be and so forth. But I just want to mention a couple of things here in response to things that both Danny and Joel have said. I'm going to respond to you first. Ideas of privacy or having zones that others cannot observe is central to human autonomy and ideas of being able to gather your thoughts away unobserved by others. Let me just give you just one short example. The secret ballot in voting is only about 150 years old. It's a phenomenon. It was an invention, and it took off like wildfire. Before that, people would stand up and say, I vote for Trump, I vote for Clinton, whatever, I vote for Jill Stein. So, but we had this idea that, hey, this allowed a better way for people to gather their thoughts, they can converse with their neighbors and express their views by a secret ballot. So that, again, became a very, very popular thing. And I would argue that not only is privacy important for the individual, it's essential to the maintenance of community and undergirds the structure of democracy. So that's in response to Joel's.
You think I disagree with that?
Well, I mean, what you said sounds like you disagree with it. The other thing, too, I want to say is that in the 20th century in the United States, we actually have a very clear idea of what privacy and personal data is. Anyone who's a lawyer, and all three of us were subject to this, I'm sure, in our training, throughout the 20th century and Prosser on, privacy law and so forth, there's a very well-articulated four-pronged test for privacy in the United States that's embodied in all 50 states, either in statute or case law or both, and that it articulates these four dimensions of privacy very clearly.
So I think we all have a very well-understood sense that there is something called privacy. I really disagree with the idea that that it's easy to get it, or that it's clear what it is in any given case, and that's why I think while it's great that there are these principles in international human rights law and in a lot of national laws, the hard part about privacy is a case by case question. It is every because there's almost no on the margins there are uses of personal information that are obviously privacy intrusions that everyone agree on, and then there at the other end. There's obviously not intrusive uses of information. And then there's this big gray area. And so my view of privacy, having worked in the federal government, seen it in the federal government, is that you have to constantly be working it through. And the question is, for any government, what kind of process does it have for actually giving people a way to have their rights protected and to be able to argue about when their privacy is being violated and when it isn't?
Now, here's the question that I want to pose to everyone in this room, including these three. First question, do you read those long statements that you consent to when you accept online services? How many of you actually read them?
The highest survey is 16% of users, but I don't believe
that. So the 16%.
That's the high water mark is 16%,
okay.
Right?
So the 16% of you that actually read them, keep your hands up, please. How many of you have declined to go with Google or Facebook or other services by virtue of what you've read?
Partially, yes.
Yeah.
Yeah, partially.
Exactly.
I don't do Facebook for that reason. But
there's a real number about this question.
The
good surveys have established that more than half of mobile apps users deny some privacy permission or another in the course of installing apps. So and the same thing is true on social networks. You look at the Facebook controls or other controls. People are using these things and doing them.
Just trying to get a sense, again, of the extent to which it's not only read, but it affects behavior.
No, people are acting on these things, absolutely.
There's a question in the back, and then we'll move up to the front. Go ahead.
Mr. Brenner, you...
I have both a question and a comment. I actually read some of those things, and one of the clauses that bothered me most in some of the things I read was they can change the rules at any time without just changing them on their website without...
So the FTC does not accept that. And any privacy policy that claims to be able to do that, if it's a company in the United States, and they did it and it harmed someone, they would be investigated by the FTC.
Okay. So, Michelle, why don't we collect a couple questions, again, questions, please, and then we'll kind of proceed to try to answer them en masse. There was a question in the back, and we'll move around here as well. Okay, go ahead.
Mr. Brenner, you mentioned cyber attacks on critical infrastructure. Have we had these happen, and if not, why not?
Okay, that's one that will keep us going for a while. Michelle, you have one in the back, and I have one here, okay?
Thank you. I just want to make a side comment, which is that in my experience, HIPAA is more about protecting doctors than about family
100%.
Privacy.
Yeah.
I resolved my dilemma about who to vote for president here in Massachusetts by writing in Edward Snowden. So I want to ask two questions that are sort of related to that. One is, I just happen to have a copy of the Constitution, and I reread the Fourth Amendment, which I think is one of maybe several guideposts for understanding privacy and its relationship to security, because it uses the language of being secure in persons, houses, papers, and effects. I remember Michael Hayden going on right in when the thing was blowing up at a press conference at the National Press Club, and he didn't even seem to understand in the most rudimentary way, the very language of the Fourth Amendment. So my two questions. Bill Binney, who was a decorated National Security Agency employee and came up with what he alleges is a software that could have done surveillance in a way that was consistent with the principles and the language of the Fourth Amendment. Do you, any of you, but Mr. Brenner in particular, do you accept his claim? I mean, he ended up having FBI agents come to his house and get him out of a shower with guns pointed at his head. Because he says he was a whistleblower. The second question is, was there mass illegal domestic gathering of information going on by the NSA, and what's been done about that?
Okay. And a question in the back.
Thank you. I was just wondering how you feel about the privatization of security knowledge in the media, for example, new vulnerabilities or tactics that bad actors can exploit being reported in the media, kind of tying it into how different countries, different governments approach this in media compliance with governments. Thank you.
Why don't we actually take these three and then we'll move to another quick lightning round.
What do you got?
Who wants to go first? Yeah.
All right, I think I'm on the hot seat here.
Yeah.
We have had attacks on infrastructure in this country that have been, I mean, I'm talking destructive attacks, not attacks after theft, that have so far been mostly unsuccessful in taking anything down and have not been able to do much damage. That's why you haven't heard about them. We have had attacks on infrastructure recently in Ukraine from the Russian side that actually disabled a significant part of the grid in that country for some time. I think the reason we haven't seen more of that so far is that the countries that would be able to do it, which would be Russia and China, don't want to start that fight any more than we do. And to that extent, I think there's a certain amount of deterrence effect that has been working. We could take down the banking system or the financial system. What would happen in that event would be world chaos. the Chinese bring down the American banking system, we have a terrible problem, we have a recession, they have a depression and maybe a change of style of government. So there's been a certain amount, I think, of successful deterrence that to that extent. That won't work against with the North Koreans. It won't work if some of the transnational terrorist groups get a hold of this capability. Capability in this area is not fundamentally a function of capital. It's a function mainly of know-how. All the groups we'd be afraid of have enough money to do it. And I think know-how is a form of knowledge, and knowledge, like water, finds its own level, which is why I'm terribly concerned about the future going forward. You want me to go on to
yeah,
the
yeah,
other?
Yeah, I want to check on.
Look,
to, yeah.
No, I, the Binney, Binney's, I don't want to go too deeply into this, but Binney's allegation was that a program called Thin Thread was a better way for NSA to run its systems than one that Hayden eventually decided to back. And I think, and to some significant extent, aspects of Thin Thread have been brought into use in the agency. Binney and his colleagues made a complaint to the Inspector General at NSA about the propriety of that procurement. I know that because I was the Inspector General. And so I'm intimately familiar with the allegations that Mr. Binney has made. Those allegations since that event are startlingly different than the ones he put before the Inspector General, which had nothing to do with civil liberties or anything else. It was fundamentally a dispute among people who were disappointed in how that procurement came out. I'm not aware of the fact, and I doubt, but that Thin Thread would have solved the problem or made it impossible somehow for NSA to get metadata. I just don't believe that. And I can say with certain that those allegations were not part of the original complaint. You asked about NSA, somebody asked about NSA illegality. Look, I opposed, and if you read in Hayden's recent memoirs, he's quite clear about it. I opposed doing the Stellar Wind program outside of FISA. I thought it was a terrible mistake. I think in its early times, in the first year or so, I don't think it was illegal, because I think as an emergency basis, the president had the power to do it regardless, under Article 2, regardless of the statute. I think thereafter it was on terribly thin ground, and there were other aspects with it too, and it worked very hard to change it. Ultimately, it was changed. I thought the idea that the metadata program should have been kept from the American public, I think, was a terrible idea. And we're
Can
paying
I
for it.
Can I comment on this? Yeah. A couple of things, very quickly. On the critical infrastructure protection, not with the Obama administration, in a way it was nice to have a break, but in the previous administrations, basically they get a retired general, they say we have to do something about critical infrastructure, and they stand up some sort of committee. Right? And they roam around and do hearings and end up doing nothing. So, and at a certain point, you were probably involved. I'd get invoked to try and help them out, and they'd do nothing. This is something we absolutely need to get our arms around. So we've wasted 20 years thinking about how to protect our critical infrastructure. There's a lot of distributed expertise. And you know what we see now are the things Joel mentioned, North Korea going around and doing things. And also, they can do things to not the United States and get away with it more. The problem with Estonia and so forth. There have been a lot of things that have happened by either state or non-state actors. This is a growing problem. It's just a matter of time. In addition, a lot of our critical infrastructure has legacy systems in it that are not well protected or defended. So, you know, but meanwhile, they're huge systems. It's hard to revise them and so forth. So that presents another vulnerability. So, you know, I hope that this is something the United States really is willing to move forward with and do something constructive about. In terms of Binney, a couple of things. I invited him up with Ron Rivest up here to MIT to give a talk in 2012. There's a YouTube video of it. I recommend you see it because he gave a very technical talk because of the audience that he was speaking to here. There's also a movie about Binney that came out last year called A Good American. It's at agoodamerican.org. I recommend it to you. It's very interesting. Binney had a 37-year career in NSA, but he rose through the ranks and was eventually supervising over 6,000 other crypto mathematicians that developed Thin Thread and so forth. His Bible was USENIX 18, and again, we don't have time to go into it here about whether or not what he could do did what he claimed it could. I think it did. Joel doesn't. Finally, I recommend to you a book by Laura Donahue, who's a national security law expert. It came out this year. I can't remember the title. Her name's Laura Donahue. She's a law professor at Georgetown.
It's called The Future of Foreign Intelligence.
There it is. Okay, and but it looks at these exact questions. She finds a number of things were clearly illegal or unconstitutional. But anyway, I recommend that you read the book. It's pretty clear for that kind of text and, you know, quite detailed.
And you should read my review of that book, which is coming out in the New England Law Review next June.
But you can hack a copy online.
So here's what I would say about Snowden and everything that we learned from that, not everything. I think the important things to learn from that experience are very much along the lines Joel suggested. You can argue a lot about the substance of the law, and you have people who I think have integrity in the intelligence community who say they did not break the law. And there's some clear examples of personal love and kind of things, but writ large for these large programs, there are people who take, I think, a good faith view that they didn't break the law. I don't personally agree with that view, but it's a good faith view. I think what Snowden revealed is that we had an absolutely inadequate oversight system following the Patriot Act, that Congress was completely incompetent at looking at the intelligence practices when they had given the intelligence community extraordinarily expanded power for reasons that are understandable, whether you agree with it or not, post 9/11, but they did not provide adequate oversight. And the FISA court, as it was constructed then, which is a very unusual instrument in the U.S. legal system, it is a court, but it meets in secret, and there's only one side of the legal issue that is presented to the judges. The judges are so isolated they can't even bring their clerks. They sit in the basement of the Justice Department and they do crossword puzzles because they can't even bring books.
The skiff's on the sixth floor.
Right.
Now.
It moved. Okay. Yeah, yeah. I think that we learned a lot about the substantive details of what authority the intelligence community should or shouldn't have. But I think what we really learned was that we had more than a decade of mostly inadequate oversight. And we also learned that it took people, whether it was James Ryden or Snowden, who were somewhere between whistleblowers and hackers, and you can argue about which, or traitors, and you can argue about which they were. But the fact is that it has always taken people like that outside the system to force the Congress and the courts to reckon with abuses of surveillance authority. And that is, a lot of people want to try to figure out what moral category do you put Edward Snowden. You can have a long debate about that, but I don't think there's actually any debate about the fact that we only have adequate oversight over our intelligence agencies when we add into the mix these whistleblower slash traitors. and that's just a complexity of our environment that we have to recognize.
And that's another whole evening's conversation.
Yeah. You may have noticed that the panel comes to complete agreement on all issues. And in fact, I actually want to note that the idea of having folks with principled disagreements and a lot of areas of agreement is one of the joys of being at this institute. Just to make your lives a little complicated, a closing remark. Joel, at the outset, said, and I quote, "Without security, there is no privacy or liberty." And I believe that the point that Joel was making, and it's always dangerous to put words in the mouth of attorneys, is that if something really awful happens, then under those circumstances, there tends to be a lashback that destroys much. And my own parents were among those who lost years of liberty after Pearl Harbor. There's also something else that we have to be worried about as well, and it is that the invocation of security as a justification for taking liberty and privacy is something that we also see in abundance. Now, I'm not asking the panel to comment on this because that would keep us here for another 8 hours.
Yeah.
But noting that both of these are actually real problems is that something that we at least agree on, and then set up for another 8 hours of debate to figure it out?
Those are well stated, in my opinion.
Okay. And on that note, we're going to draw this to a close, but those of you with questions should please feel free to come up. And I really want to thank our panelists for a wonderful evening.